It's how to optimize your campaigns and acquire the most valuable users. And that is really the topic. That is what it's all about. And I am really pleased to see everyone here. I'm your moderator. I'm Peggy Ann Salz, founder of MobileGroove, which is my app marketing and content marketing consultancy, but also writing for Forbes, writing for Pocket Gamer, writing about many of your companies and working with you and hearing great growth stories, especially from our growth marketers here, whom I'm going to introduce, but I'll start here and just move over. We have Cyril Caël. Okay. Cyril joined AppLovin in 2017, now director business for EMEA, where he's responsible for helping app developers grow their business through UA and monetization. Seen it from both sides, I think that's really exciting on a panel like this because he knows app developer pain points because before joining AppLovin, he was the UA manager at Gameloft, where he designed and managed mobile marketing advertising campaigns. Little known fact, because he is the only one who answered my question for what I wouldn't find on your LinkedIn profile. Little known fact, he studied physics and chemistry. Not much use here, of course, but I would say his knowledge bombs are going to be explosive. Alex, I'll continue down. We have Alex Pham. You know what a knowledge bomb is, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, okay. This guy's up. Okay, Alex, VP EMEA Adjust, where he leads all things partnerships with advertising partners, tech platforms, media agencies across EMEA and APAC. On a daily basis, he's pushing product development, sales, marketing, go-to-market initiatives with major partners like Facebook, Google, Snap, Twitter, Apple, and many more. And has tons of insights into activations and events, which is, of course, why he's here to share that valuable advice. And if you want to, you can add something I won't find on your LinkedIn profile. No? No, okay. He's going to be the mystery man. All right. Alexey, Gusev, lead game marketing at Good Game Studios, a German-based producer creating free-to-play web and mobile games, first dabbling in digital marketing in Russia, coming over to Berlin, and recently also dabbling in the guitar, but we won't go there. He's fresh from a game launch, which I think is really interesting. So he will be able to talk about how he acquired quality players from the get-go, which is some challenge that many of you may also be facing. And finally, Alper Taner, the man, our full-stack growth marketer, strategist, executor, 9 years experience in marketing, 7 years in performance marketing, a veteran with an impressive track record. We've been running into each other over the years, thousands of user campaigns, user acquisition campaigns with annual eight-figure budgets, including unicorns, which is why he's here. And an interesting point, his clients regularly feature in the App Store and TechCrunch and Forbes. So it's someone you want to have on speed dial if you're serious about growth, Alper. So with that, no pressure, guys. It's a rock star panel. I'm going to start with a question just to get us thinking about what we need to do to get ready for insane growth. So we're going to talk about the myths about the misconceptions around user acquisition, especially what it takes to acquire high quality users. So I'll just go down here. I'll go from Alper up. What is the myth? What is the myth that you think stands out? And why do you think people are holding on to this outdated notion around acquiring high value users? I'll take you, Alper.
I think the myth could be like, there's one size fits all when it comes to the newest trends. Like when someone says, yeah, AAA works, and then everyone wants to go AAA everywhere in all markets and for all their apps and games and such. So I think that's a myth, because in our experience, like, yeah, AAA might work, but it works in some specific markets and for some specific apps. But that doesn't mean that we just go all in AAA, as an example. So okay. That's the first thing that comes to mind.
All right. Alexey, what about you?
I guess that acquiring valuable users is very expensive. You can actually acquire valuable users for your app at a rather cheaper rates as well. It kind of depends on how you do that, the ins and outs of the marketing campaigns, like the creative and all the things behind that as well.
That's good news. Alex.
I think there is a misconception around user acquisition becoming easier and easier with, you know, automation tools, everything coming up. Actually, it's becoming a bit more complex. We've seen it with the recent changes with iOS 14. Platforms are offering automation, but there is also a lot of work to be done around these tools to customize them and making it like a better, well-oiled machine.
Mm-hmm. Cyril?
Thank you. I think there's a myth around, it's a recent myth, which is it's impossible to buy now on iOS for, like, since iOS 14.5. So it's definitely more complex. There's more struggles, more hurdles, but it's definitely possible to do acquisition. So maybe we'll touch on that, I think, at the end of the panel.
Absolutely, because that's the good news, because I've heard exactly that. It's just like, just move the budget to Android and we'll be done with it. But there are some marketers who can't do that at all. So we've heard about the myths. Now we're going to get down into the reality of optimizing for insane growth. And I'll start with our marketers, because to do this, you have to optimize your campaign. You have to know what an engaged or a valuable, high-value user looks like to begin with. Alper, what about you? What do they look like now, and how has that changed? You know, are there the signs or the pre-indicator indicators that you have a high-value user? You know what you're looking for. What do they look like?
I think for any e-commerce, it's all about high AOV users. Mm-hmm. And I think it's pretty straightforward. Like, the users like that buy immediately and then they continue purchasing are obviously the most valuable in the shortest period of time, at least as an indicator. Mm-hmm. And in terms of what have changed, I think the definition of the valuable user like haven't really changed, but how to identify them might have changed, like, because now you don't really have cohorting side of things much on iOS 14 anymore. So you have to rely on the first hours to indicate like some signals in terms of their predictive LTV and so on. Mm-hmm. So definition haven't changed, but how to find them, I think, changed.
Yeah, how to find them and the signals as well.
Yeah.
Alexey, you have just launched a game, new game. Congratulations. Little shameless plug for it.
Warlines, everyone, please
Warlines,
install.
Everyone, you heard it. You heard it here. So what about that? I mean, you're obviously also having to look for engaged, valuable players, but also having to switch it up a little bit. You know, how are you approaching this differently? This is a new game, so you don't really have a lot to go by, except, of course, your experience with all your other games. So what do they look like to you?
Yeah, I guess for us, it's not about switching up things much. It's more about ticking all the right boxes. So in order to exactly understand who the valuable users are, it's about figuring out and setting up the proper funnel in-game as well on the with the MMP of your choice, however you're tracking the users. So obviously purchases are coming from the gaming side, in-game advertisement, that's completely different, let's say, sides of the story, then you need to understand how the users are retaining, how you're retaining the users, the churn rates, how to figure out the events. And on top of that, it's obviously there is a certain level of automation. You can kind of trust in to a certain extent into your VO campaigns of Facebook. However, in the current SCAD reality or SCAN campaigns, there are other ways how you can acquire the users through the proxy events or through the proxy parameters of them. So you definitely need to realize that as well.
Mm-hmm. And we're going to get to picking those proxies and digging a little bit deeper. But talking about understanding who the valuable users are, that's just half the battle. Cyril, I want to come to you because you need a proper infrastructure to execute on growth plans. What's involved here? Where do marketers struggle? We have a lot of change in the last year. We're heading into another year of change, probably Google following more and Android following more like Apple. So let's start with just getting this ready, this mindset. They know what the user looks like. How do I set up to get them?
So before tapping into the infrastructure per se, I think the definition of a valuable user, as you said, is very challenging to figure out. Mm-hmm. So depending on if you have like a gaming business, non-gaming business, subscription subscription business, it will vary a lot. And also within one app, you can also monetize through in-app purchases, subscriptions, ads, and so on. So you really have to build, so first you hire the right people to evaluate that. So have a strong BI team, for example, have some good data analysts that can really figure this out for you. And then you will have all the data points to act, to effectively buy for those users. So that means you will have different pools of users that you need to tap into and to acquire, meaning as many strategies to execute on. Mm-hmm. So it's really key to get that infrastructure built. To really get a full picture of what your users are and then adjust your strategies accordingly.
So where do they struggle? Is it getting the data points? Is it maybe trying to do too much at once? I've heard a number of marketers just in the morning say, hey, you know, it's about get it right, get it concrete, and then scale, then grow. Where do they struggle?
I think really, really working backwards. Traditionally, you'll see, let's say, the end value, of, as in you want to get a purchasers in your app, for example, if you have an e-commerce app or any app with in-app purchases. So once you have that, how do you work backwards? So it's really about building that, working actually backwards in the funnel, mm-hmm. to try to identify those events that make sense before. So this is the struggle. This is what Alexey touched on, which is really trying to find the high value proxy events that you mm-hmm. can buy for and target in the first place earlier at a lower cost than your just purchaser campaign.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And we'll get to those as well. But Alex, I also want to hear from your perspective. Again, we're talking about how marketers get started, stay focused. Most important things to consider when you're setting up the conversion tracking and the app campaign. I mean, what are some, again, in those early stages, what they should have in mind or top of mind?
I mean, coming back to what Cyril said, it's depending on what's your business model, really. Like your mm-hmm. app has certain goals. If the goal is to generate a subscription, if it's to deliver a first order, if it's to monetize through ads, I think that's how you need to, that's where you need to match your early event and engagement from your users as much as possible. Right now, UA managers have to have strategies for Android. They have to have strategies for iOS. For iOS specifically, needing to understand what are the limitation of measurement, the challenges that they will have with setting up conversion value and everything that really will help them assess very early on what will make a valuable user. Mm-hmm. If, let's say, a good user for Gorilla would be, I see that they are browsing certain categories, certain items, they are spending a certain amount of time in the app at the very beginning, in the first hour, let's say. All these early engagements have to really make me decide how I want to build the funnel later on. Mm-hmm. Given how data is more difficult to get from engagement, I think advertisers also have a task to measure other types of events. There is a new word in the market, which is zero-party data. And this is basically related to not first-party data, which is, you know, age, demographic, and so on, but more like what are the specific parameters and settings the users will make within your app. So if it's an e-commerce app, it might be like, the preference, the category of items that they are looking for. So it's a bit more related to what the user is expecting in terms of engagement and what the app should also recommend them later on when you use them.
Mm-hmm. So very much those behavioral data and metrics. Speaking of that, you know, part of setting this is about the app and the goals, but also understanding the benchmarks out there. And I wanted to stay in this sort of like this beginning phase, because again, Adjust, reading your reports, AppLovin, working in your network, everything that you're seeing. Can you shed some light on some of the benchmarks that you consider to be significant, or you know, what you can help marketers in their efforts to shape their budgets, their strategies. What can you share? Want to start?
Okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, benchmark is kind of difficult, I would say, for when we help our customers, at least. I think the approach that we see with advertisers is that we have a much closer relationship with them since all these changes happen, because they also need our guidance, let's say, in defining what are the important KPIs and what is important to measure. And we need to adapt also our way of assessing the performance and the measurement that we have for their app, which comes to what Alper was mentioning with predictive LTV. What are the early engagement events that you can set in order to have revenue buckets that you can then do predictive analytics on it? So that's where we see a really customized approach for each of the customers we are dealing with on this problem, on these challenges.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, 100% to that. I think what really matters is to really have a proper conversation with your, as a marketer, to have a proper conversation with your ad network rep, for example, just to really understand what it can provide to you, how the optimizations will work, and so on. Because it's very much tailor-made. So, of course, there are some industry standards, but from one e-commerce app or mobility app to another, the break-even windows might be different, the conversion funnel might be different. So we can always share, okay, maybe we see like for the first ride, it's going to cost you $50 to acquire a user, right? That doesn't mean that it's going to be the same for the other mobility app. So really, have this conversation, this honest conversation with the network you work with, to really build that strategy together, see what works best, see what events matter, and then just move up or down, actually, in the funnel to get to that valuable user at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's really hard to share benchmarks. I mean, there are case studies out there. You can always consult those. But it's really a one-to-one conversation to be had.
But a great segue to you as well, Alper, because it's about understanding growth. It's about understanding that proxy for high-value users, for high-quality users. It's critical. It's a challenge. But this is what you do all the time at Gorillas, across your career. What can you share? What's some advice you can share about picking that proxy event? Because it's part predictive. It's part, it's definitely data-driven, but there's also a level of just deep understanding or intuition, whatever you want to call it. There's a hunch in there as well, is what I want to say.
Yeah, I think there are multiple dimensions. Like, one is to understand your own data, mm-hmm. and then other one is to make the algorithms understand your data. So then it's very important to send the full user funnel to the platforms that you're working with, so that they can improve their bidding and auctioning algorithms better. Because when you make sure that you send your full funnel to the network, let's say like Facebook, then as Facebook is optimizing their own ad serving based on the eCPM, and that is calculated based on the conversion rates of the funneling conversion, then you actually improve your campaigns just by doing that, because you're giving the algorithm the right signals. Then algorithm knows, okay, if I show this ad to this user at this placement at this time of the day, I know that there's an 80% chance that he will convert, and it's worth this much, and then advertiser pay this much, and so on. So that's like one layer. And other layers, of course, for you to understand, if user does this, he will do that kind of understanding. Mm-hmm. But all in all, it comes down to your event setup should give you how to calculate your CAC, but also your event setup should tell you how to calculate your ROAS. It's not sufficient to just have one purchase event or one single event for your monetization. So mm-hmm. it needs to be broken down in a meaningful way that helps to support both your internal metrics, but also help support the algorithms that you're buying from.
That's really interesting. So you're doing well for your data, understanding that, ingesting that, also with your partner together. Now, Alexey, you have it a little bit different, because you could say that if something isn't working, then try something else. But your workaround is a little bit more difficult, because you're very focused on iOS users for your game. You can't simply switch budget. What is it that you're doing there? Tell me a little bit about, the good news is that you can do it. We heard from Alex. How are you doing it? What are some workarounds? Because it's a very identity, IDFA constrained world for you.
Yeah, definitely. I also wanted to comment on the previous topic of the proxies, if you don't mind,
very quickly to cover that.
It sounds relatively simple when you're talking about, unfortunately, there is no single silver bullet for that. And I had just to kind of temper your expectations about that. I have seen cases where the proxy events worked marvelously in terms of the acquiring the paying users. In the other events or for the other products, for the other games, I have seen when algorithms are quite smart, if you tell them to optimize towards the event A, you will get the users that will definitely convert towards the event A, but it doesn't really mean that you will get the purchases, or not necessarily. You really need to understand deeply your product for that. And as Alper has mentioned, basically have multiple things that are in the purchase funnel. Mm-hmm. Sorry about that.
No. I'd love to follow up with that because you've done trial and error. What have you learned from that? How many events should you have? Or there's a certain way to choose them? Because that is the beginning of everything. You optimize according to what you think are going to bring the user in, put them in the funnel that you want, monetize your app in the way you want. What have you learned? What are some failures you can share?
Failures are
or openly share, Alexey, put it that way.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's put it like this. We have tried to, for the other products, not for the game in question that we launch currently, but for the other products where we had way more data, we kind of experimented with the events that correlated highly with the purchases. Unfortunately, and logically so, correlation, not always causation, we kind of failed. And to be more precise, those were the app open. So people that are browsing in the app store, they might be interested in getting the purchase. But when we kind of filled out the funnel, we ran the marketing campaigns, we told the algorithms to optimize exactly towards that. This is what we got. We got the users that were browsing through the App Store, but we never managed to convert them. We managed to convert them through the retargeting campaigns later, but that's a bit different question. So there was definitely value to that as well. On the other hand, the example that we had, for example, we have seen a huge churn rate at a point A, and the people that were getting post the churn rate A, let's put it like this, they were converting to payers at a way higher rate. So we try to optimize them exactly to get the users that are getting post that point of time. And this is what that kind of has brought the success for us when optimizing towards the proxy events. But again, there is no silver bullet for that. You need mm-hmm. to understand your product. You need to kind of have tailor-made decisions for every stop. Probably getting back to what Alper has said in the beginning that there is no single solution to everything. You kind of need to.
So, where do you go for advice?
Work with your BI team.
Okay.
Work with your product team. Work with your community very closely. Usually, when people are eager, like when they fancy the product, they're very much eager to give feedback on that. You just need to listen effectively. And then they will tell you what they want, what brings them to purchase, what they like, what they don't like, and how you can improve that.
Mm-hmm. I want to skip around because I also wanted to check and see as we go along if there are other questions as we have just sort of coming into each theme and each topic area, because we've been discussing automation. I'd like to actually get to that because that's part of it. We're talking about the algorithm. Now, it's interesting, Cyril, you told me that you're seeing massive growth. You know, you told me more than 70% of advertisers running automated campaigns. What does that mean? Could you unpack that number for me and help me understand the role of UA automation in acquiring high-value users? Because that has certainly evolved.
Yeah, of course. So to be more precise, it's actually 70% of the spend.
Of the 77
of the spend on the platform is automated. Mm-hmm. So by automated,
significant.
yeah, it's pretty huge. And it was much lower before, obviously. Yeah. So yeah. It keeps growing because also we're building tools that allow for that. But at the end of the day, the end goal is really to move away from CPI as much as possible, because CPI is going against what we just described about trying to automate the purchasing to the right events for the right user as well. So having said that, there are different ways to automate the purchase, right? So you can do either target events, so the events that we identified, like identified with your BI team and so on before, and the ones that are proxy for high value users. So the second one is trying to target purchasers from the get-go. So this is pretty costly, especially if your conversion rate to purchaser is pretty low. So that's why you will want to go usually through those CPE, CPA, so cost per event or cost per action in the first place, to try to lower your learning cost as much as possible, because you will already find higher value users than just regular installs, so what Facebook, for example, would call MAI, so max app installs. So you really want to move away from that and get to a state where you can go towards something more AEO or VO, like value optimized. So value optimized, also like different ways. So you can optimize towards proper revenue value. So whether it comes from advertising revenue or in-app purchase revenue. Mm-hmm. So it's what we call ADROAS, in-app ROAS. So move to a place where all those campaigns now have really overtaken CPI, because CPI at the end of the day is just worth little, unless you're really trying to push your app through the charts and really acquire a lot of users at once, but you really effectively want to stay away from CPI as much as possible.
Mm-hmm. What about automation for you, Alper? How do you see that? Because it has many sides, many layers. What stage do you even consider automation at? It sounds now very much more to be very central, even for smaller companies, on smaller budgets for that matter.
Yeah, regarding budgets, in my experience, like, I've never get into automation if the budget is less than 10K a month.
Okay.
It's just because you can handle it prior to that. Depends on your complex, but you don't have a complex setup if you have only 10,000 a month. And then when it comes to automation, I think there's a kind of a misperception in industry that automation is always about bids and budgets. Like, but there's a lot more to automation. Like, I think automation is at the setup phase, optimization phase, and its reporting phase. And I think the whole industry always talks about the optimization phase, how we can optimize, but it's also about launching campaigns. Like, I think it's also very common in gaming that you can just launch in bulk, like the creatives or the new audiences and stuff like that, just by using the API instead of doing it manually. And then optimization, I mean, we all know about the bids and budgets and the creative optimization based on the rule sets that we have. But also the reporting side of things, like pulling the cost data in, and then your MMP and then the dashboards, whatever you want to merge. That's also, in my opinion, under the automation side of things. Everything that you do manually could be automated in to some certain extent. Of course, there are the limitations. But I think it's not about should we do automation or not. What can we automate within these layers, and what makes sense for the business at that stage? Of course, to scale, you need automation, in my experience. And it's almost always worked in a positive way.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not about just bids and budgets, but it's about all these three layers. So that you need to think about and see what can you make use of. So if you might be spending 10K, but you can still automate the reporting, although it doesn't make sense for the bids and budget allocation across channels and such. So it's not a yes or no question. It's more about what makes sense for the business at that stage, and what are the business requirements and your scaling roadmap.
Mm-hmm. Alexey, where are you in your automation journey currently?
Yeah, coming from a multi-portfolio gaming company, multi-partner gaming company, this is what we kind of have to rely on our everyday activities. And as Alper has said, I can only second that. It's at every stage that you're interested in having that, in setting up the campaigns, in optimizing the campaigns, in reporting, like creative reporting recently, not recently, but since years, been a very huge thing. And especially it's a very huge thing in gaming. That's what we kind of live and breathe by, so to say. So understanding what works, what not, doing massive tests, having all the data in one place, being able to compare that with other products, that's what we kind of needed to have. Going away obviously from the more obvious things like value optimization, TROS, that almost every other partners have, and definitely like you kind of need to get to that, and you will feel the bump in terms of the better results that you're getting. To kind of tease, it's not going to be as easy as you have automation and then it works. I would love to. And it's like having a value opt campaign, 5K budget daily, and then you're golden. There is obviously way more things behind that as well that are requiring, unfortunately, manual things.
I mean, another thing that you can do to optimize for growth is also the creative. I thought maybe, Cyril, you could talk a little bit about that because you're seeing so much around that. Is there something you can tell us about trends out there or what you're seeing that works? Because that's the one thing that it's not necessarily just is a question of a silver bullet solution. This is something marketers can control. What are you seeing?
You can definitely automate production of creatives. So that's something that we see across the board. Like all our marketers do that. All of the partners we work with do that. So pretty easy to implement, like small iterations and so on. I think what really matters is how you can find new concepts. And this is hardly automated. So that's really what matters, what makes a campaign scale or another campaign like Plumet, for example. Mm-hmm. So you really want to work with your creative team on that. And then, of course, with small iterations. Then in terms of purely trends when it comes to creatives, I think it would require a proper like session. So I think like we have a great panel of marketers in the room and probably from very different verticals. So each vertical has its own way. But
yeah, thank you.
But yeah, at the end of the day, I think what's really important is to know what formats, for example, are predominant in the industry. So
what's hot in the formats?
So yeah, so what we see on our platform, for example, would be videos definitely running the show. Mm-hmm. So I think it's probably 95% of the spend on the platform comes from videos, and videos that are paired with what we call end cards. So those end cards can be static, can be animated, can be interactive, playable. Mm-hmm. And these are actually the one that moves the needle, the end cards. So you can have like an end card that would be a static end card, fine. But you can also have like some kind of more immersive engagement from the user, like immersive interaction from the user. And then usually what we see is that it results into higher engagement from the user in the app after. Mm-hmm. So you really want to focus on building those with your creative teams. And it's not easy. It requires quite some resources. It's usually costly. It's hard to find guys, like people who can build those and internalize that resource. So there's like some companies we probably all know about who can build those for you, but at a cost. So you need to understand what you're doing when you do that. And you really need to understand your product because you will want to really shorten that user experience within one ad that can be engaged with within 15 to 20 seconds, and that the user will really understand what it's all about. But yeah, it's not revolutionary, but videos, playable end cards, playable as standalones, are still the ones running the show these days.
I'll add to that, Alex, because one thing is to optimize through creatives, but you also said that the
good news is that it's also not as hard to optimize on Apple as we thought. iOS 14 is not the issue that we thought it was. Why do you say that? That's pretty controversial. Most people are still suffering. Look at this room.
It's not exactly
okay.
That easy, yeah, for sure. It's not what I exactly meant by that. It's just that there are ways around. Well, I mean,
okay, sure, workaround. We're all waiting. That's what they're here for.
Yeah. So, I mean, there was a lot of information over there. Just going back on some CPIs benchmark bad. Don't try to just think like one CPI will solve everything and anything like that. Going back to also what Alper said, that's also about the prep work. Like if you want to have an efficient predictive system, if you want to have as many insights as you had before with before iOS 14, you need to have that prep work done very well. And this really involves having to work with your partners, understand what your MMP can send to your buying engine and what exactly will they be able to do in terms of optimization. It's not only bids, it's not only budget, it's everything in between. It's what the engines are able to do on the buying side and what are the signals that they need. And then later on going to measurement and how do you look at the performance of your campaigns after they run. It's going back to the predictive side, setting up the right early KPIs and work with your MMP of choice in order to customize your predictive models. I think this is a prerequisite and we will go into a direction where it will become a must as well. Like all the prep work you also do in having as much consented data and consented users who are sharing that data together with, maximizing your opt-in and making sure that you have as much deterministic data as possible. All of this will play a role after that in how efficient your automation is, how your buying engine will be able to perform their campaigns. So it's all of this in between, but it requires quite some work, a lot of understanding also from UA managers now are probably very different profiles than they were before. You need to be technical because it's becoming super technical topics that we have to deal with. And you want to be aware of it because it's new information really every month. It's creative. We talked about the creative side. You want to understand what works, what doesn't work. Also, what you think works might not really be the thing that will actually work in the end. Overall curiosity as well. Like we are going into also there are new channels that can be leveraged. You need to be curious about, is this where I'm going to find my audience? Is this really where I can find new pocket of users that will be good for my business?
Mm-hmm. Those are a lot of questions to raise, and that's why I wanted to open up the floor for any questions, because we certainly have the experts here, been there, done that. If you have any questions, otherwise I will. Yes.
Yeah, good question. So traditionally, it's for gaming in most cases. We've also seen cases where interactive ads, so you can call them playable if you want, but let's say interactive, like engaging ads, work for non-gaming as well. So it can be in mobility, it can be in e-commerce, and so on. So try to find some kind of hook that you can propose to your user while showing an ad. And that user will definitely find himself engaged in the app more afterwards. What's really important to avoid, especially if you run those value optimized campaigns, app event optimized campaigns, and so on, whatever name the network you work with calls them, you will want to avoid an ad that misleads the user. So we see a lot of that in gaming, but also an ad that will tell the user, for example, to interact with the creative. And then when he clicks on it, it gets redirected right away to the store. So this is pretty bad usually because the user will maybe install the app, but has no way to interact with the app or has a bad feel about the app already. And it does translate in the numbers where the quality of the user is traditionally lower from those ads in particular. So, I mean, static ads work still pretty well. I mean, videos and then static end cards is still a good combination for e-commerce, for example. I see you're from Vinted, right? So e-commerce, that works pretty well. So anything non-gaming, video plus static works really well. Show what your product is all about. Have a pretty fun concept in the video that works pretty well. There are some trends in gaming, in non-gaming, and so on that are very specific. But again, I think it's a broad topic. But don't try to make it too engaging if there's nothing really that you feel is engaging with the ad. Just stay with video and static, I think is the advice.
Any other questions?
I think beyond ads also you have new development made by Apple with like app clips and custom product pages that can be worked in combination with whatever you're doing on the ad side. You know, having like a common user experience design in all of this will be also valuable.
Question in the back?
Question probably is more to Alexey and Alper. Do you use any internal machine learning models for video decisions on any sources, maybe programmatic or something like that? And if not, what other automation do you use for your partners?
So machine learnings, yes, we do have that. We have the bidder model for the video networks. That's one thing that we are working internally. We try to hook up the external solutions for that. We haven't seen that it worked better for us when, for example, working with the DSPs. Apart from that, creation of some campaigns, we tried playing around with the APIs, and that had a positive effect on that. I also know companies that are doing or like having their own in-house solution for that. Creative reporting was definitely one of the biggest time sinks for us. And the solutions for that were very much helpful, whether it be in the internal in-house solution or it be in the external provider, of whom there are quite a lot of, I bet, even in this conference as well.
On our side, the only thing I can share is like it's in progress. And there is no right solution for in-house or external. It's about the speed, and as I said, like we focus on these three main layers, and then see what we can automate in a fastest way possible. But it's all in progress.
Any other questions? I know we're coming to a close. I wanted to ask you what to do when all data is not really useful, but because that is the case, maybe just to throw that out, because that was something I had from social media. It's like, not all data consists of useful data. How do you optimize data or make those choices? Maybe just a really quick round of that for the purpose of answering that question from that I got in from social media.
Anyone? I mean, it depends on the definition of non-usable data. Are we talking about unattributed data? Are we talking about...
I think we're just talking about data since IDFA in an IDFA limited world.
I mean, it's still a data. Like, it's just non-PII data, but it's still aggregated data. Mm-hmm. So I don't think there is nonsense data. There is less useful data.
Yeah.
But they're not completely useless. And I think you, as a marketer, you should be making sense of like this kind of data. And then data itself, like one data set itself might not be helpful, but then you can always look at the relative data sets to interpret, does this make sense alone? Not maybe. But when you compare it with, let's say, some conversion bits coming from X network and that you cannot really associate because of the whole conversion delay and data delay, you cannot associate to that cohort and the spend, but then you can still do that among the other channels, as an example. So I don't think there's a useless data, but there's just less useful data.
You have to look at it more holistically. And that gives me to the, that brings me to the last question, actually, to wrap up about trends, technologies, anything that you are watching that can help advertisers get more high value users. I'll start with you and work my way down, because I have a different question for the marketers. So you're helping advertisers get more value, high value users. Trends, technologies, channels to watch.
I'll double down on the channels, I think. So I think in the old world, so to say, like pre-iOS 14, many marketers were relying mostly on one channel, like a couple of channels, maybe like Facebook and Google, or maybe another channel on top of that. So with the loss of identification from the opt-out, it's hard to really rely on those networks solely. So we see Facebook took a hit, for example. So you can't really get your full growth strategy relying on one network only, on a couple networks only. So branch out a little bit, check what networks have to offer in terms of automation, in terms of scale. So really have those conversations with the different networks out there. Really see what they offer in terms of automation, for example, again. Mm-hmm. And there should be more relay, let's say, to what you were doing before, if not more. You can find more scale than so that's, I think, back to what we were saying before. iOS is not dead per se. Like on AppLovin, for example, it's still like 50% of the spend is on iOS. It used to be 60%, but it's still 50%. So okay. There are definitely some success stories on iOS, post iOS 14. And in the vast majority of cases, nothing really has changed, to be honest. So we are capturing also some of that, networks are all capturing some of that demand that was flowing through Facebook before or from Google before. And then there are ways to redistribute that and find more scale. Yeah.
Okay. Some tips from you, Alex.
Is this when we talk about NFT and metaverse kind of?
It's kind of cool, but I don't know if it's going to help you optimize for high value users.
In terms of trends, this is way too early, I guess. But we see a lot of consolidation in the market for sure. So it's, I think, becoming easier to also challenge your advertising partners into understanding what they do, what's their supply. And I think advertisers should keep on doing that. And there is a lot of innovation, and you will have few key players that really will come out of it. In terms of new channels as well to explore, I would say two things that are quite interesting is connected TV, obviously. Mm-hmm. We spend a lot of time with another device, which is our TV as well. And there are also interesting moments when to capture users there. And another one would be everything related to in-game advertising as well. New platforms being built to basically advertise in front of you wherever you are spending time on. Like it's an evolution, I would say, of the supply side, but one that is quite interesting and becoming more immersive.
Mm-hmm. Alexey, what about you? Is that exciting for you as you look into 2022? What do you see as the biggest opportunity, the biggest way to get more, extract more value out of your high-value users? To optimize, what are you looking at? And everyone will take notes.
To be honest, what I'm looking forward to, and not really looking forward to, the privacy changes, or like it is the privacy-centric world that we are living in now. I think all the companies are now going to be doubling down on that, like with a Google maybe going a bit less hardcore way than what Apple dropped a bomb on us end of April, but it's definitely the direction where it's going to go. And this is like, you basically need to build your marketing mix around that. Mm-hmm. Influencers is one of the things is obviously is growing, is going to be growing. It is there to stay. It's how the users are consuming the data. There is a certain element of genuity, being genuine is effectively in there. On top of that, I have seen experiences of, having great success of using the influencer creative in the paid UA is definitely one of that. Try to expand your horizons. I don't know, podcasts, connected TV. There are quite a lot of things. Investing in brands is also another opportunity. Also for the gaming, it's like I have seen that it brings good yields. To some extent, we're back to the certain Wild West situation that we had in the beginning of the marketing, and that's exactly where the opportunities are going to be coming from, in my mind.
So everyone will be looking for that growth hack, that growth tip. Alper, I'll end with you then, because that's your business, is to uncover those opportunities. What do you see on the horizon? What are you excited about? What can you leave everyone here with something to start exploring when they get back to the office on Monday, or home office?
Yeah, I think I agree with everyone about the expanding new channels, trying new channels. But I think when you do that, you need to be mindful of the limitations of the privacy thresholds, and basically iOS 14 related potential issues, because when you start spreading multiple multiple channels at a low budget just to test it out with a low budget, and then you don't see the conversions because of the privacy threshold is not met, then you might be disappointed. So that's something to, I think, pay attention to. And I still talk to a lot of advertisers, and then what I hear is like the whole iOS 14 topic is still not super clear, like in terms of how to navigate around it, how to utilize the numbers, why conversion bits versus like just a like a conversion value mapping and so on, or why conversion window of X hours versus Y hours and all that. I think it's still confusing, and best thing you can do is like really nail down on that. And then again, on top of the when testing channels, I've also heard from advertisers like, yeah, we tested X channel for 4 days, it didn't work, we paused it and so on. So that's also something that you want to avoid at all times, but also next year. And yeah, I would say like double down on the understanding the restrictions of the iOS 14 when you do this new exploration. And then when you test something, have the hypothesis in mind, and then have multiple experiments, kind of mini roadmaps for that channel before you call, okay, it doesn't work for us. Because I've even heard advertisers saying, oh, we stopped Google iOS, UAC iOS campaigns because it didn't work for us. That's not a really excuse. Like, what did you try to make it work? And then if there is like, okay, there's the 20 things we tried in the 2-3 months and it didn't work out, then I understand. But most likely it's like, yeah, because we cannot attribute with our MMP and stuff like that, which is not, I think, good enough reasons, because market is getting tougher in terms of how to acquire users. And we need to be more solution oriented rather than playing the victim mindset. Oh, we don't get the data or and such. So.
Okay. Well, we're over time, but we have a lot to think about, a lot of knowledge bombs there. I want to thank our panel. I want to thank you for attending.